Morning, everyone. That's good. Yeah. So you've had your cup of coffee, yeah? That's right. So I think yesterday was, you know, pretty interesting, where we you know, spoke about more to do with building engineering, you know, and how to make sustainability a feature in all the buildings that we design. And I quite liked, you know, Mr. Lalit Verma from Apollo mentioning that probably architects should take it upon themselves and say that we will not design a hospital unless it is green. It takes a lot of guts, but I think something like that probably will, you know, help to propagate this theme. And we would, of course, you know, have some other platforms also where we will try and popularize this, you know, feature. Also, a good takeaway was, you know, the amount of electricity that you save, you know, is quite phenomenal. You know, and Mr. Anand Padmanabhan from Kauai Medical Center was quite eloquent when he described how do you go about doing it, even if you are an existing hospital. So today we have, you know, the day starts again with a panel discussion. Little bit of a, you know, bad news, you know, in the sense that two of the panelists mentioned here have not been able to make it, but I'm sure that, you know, the other three would be able to, you know, fill in that gap quite easily, and I would lean on the audience. We have, you know, Dr. Girdhar Gyani here with us, you know, the man who launched, you know, NABH as a program. So please give him a round of applause, you know, we need, and he did that despite being not a medical man, all right. He is an aviation, he was from aviation industry and he walked into healthcare and did such a fantastic, you know, a turnaround for hospitals, and now NABH. Yeah, he's a doctor, he's a PhD, yeah. All right, so today's, you know, the topic that, you know, we are going to start with is to do with using lean design and technology to build operationally efficient hospitals and at the same time enhance patient experience, you know. So it's not only about, you know, building an infrastructure, it's also about using technology, and you try and see how it helps, you know, patients when they experience your hospital in terms of patient bed, you know, bedside patient care or queuing mechanisms or appointment systems. You know, you have a lot of many new startups which are, you know, programmed around that. And to I will just read out the names of, you know, the panelists. Mr. Joy Chakraborty, Chief Operating Officer, PD Hinduja Hospital. Joy, could you come on the stage, please? Over this time, you know, been with Hinduja, he has played an important role in planning and implementation of business strategies for the hospitals. He was instrumental in starting the MBA program in Hospital and Health Systems Management at Sri Ramchandra University, Chennai, where he was working as an honorary assistant professor. He has been also a visiting faculty in many of the academic courses for nursing as well as health administration. He has attended various advanced management programs, finance for business leaders from IIM Ahmedabad, management development program from Harvard Business School. And off late, you know, he has taken the mantle of chairing the CII Western Region Healthcare Subcommittee, and I must say that he is doing a fantastic job. You know, out of that, we had a very, very successful conference about a month back, you know, from CII, and we would like more participation into Western Region CII Subcommittee of Healthcare. You're free to talk to him post that session. Next is Mr. Satish Singh, Executive Director, Meditrina Hospitals and Diagnostics. He's an alumnus of AIIMS, All India Institute of Medical Sciences, New Delhi, with 2 decades of experience in healthcare, serial entrepreneurship, something that India needs, healthcare investments, healthcare projects, and operational management. And after his UG and PG in medicine, he then went on to undertake a doctoral program in clinical immunology. He has several first author publications in leading international journals for infection diseases and immunology. Satish has further training in healthcare, strategic management, finance, M&A, you know, merger and acquisition, business valuation and operations. He's also an investor in healthcare technology startup company focused on wearable devices for personal health tracking. So me and Joy, probably both of us need that, you know. He has more than 4 years hands-on experience in Indian healthcare, private equity funds, and was and has invested in Meditrina Hospitals, Diagnostics, as I think first a consultant and then as a partner. He was part of the Ivan Medcare, owned by ICICI Ventures, and later became CEO of Dutch healthcare fund Stalmark Capital. Is that the right pronunciation? Okay. So he is, you know, so you have seen a doctor who's worn many hats about, you know, been looking after his patients. And currently, Satish is executive director of Meditrina Hospitals and Diagnostics, which is based out of Nagpur. The last one on the, to be called on stage is Dr. Santosh Shetty, Chief Operating Officer, Kokilaben Ambani Hospital. He has over 18 years of experience in senior leadership roles at top hospitals of Mumbai. After doing his graduation, you know, from Mumbai University in MBBS, he followed it up with an MHA, Master's in Hospital Administration from TISS. I'm proud to be, you know, someone who taught him. So it makes me very proud. Santosh has done advanced management program at the NUS, you know, National University Singapore, and is also an NABH assessor. So, you know, Dr. Gyani has already blessed him. In past, Santosh has held senior positions like CEO at Breach Candy Hospital in Mumbai, head of medical services at Wockhardt Hospitals, and currently is working as executive director and chief operating officer at Kokilaben Ambani Hospital, Andheri. He has been part of the hospital for past 12 years and has been involved from the project stage, including planning, commissioning, and operations, you know, of the hospital. So we have a very, you know, august panel here. Please a round of applause for them. All right. So so we've had a fairly, you know, eloquent session yesterday on building engineering, and Satish was here, so he's aware of that. But today we are going to talk more about how to, you know, get leaner, and in that sense maybe meaner, okay, and then improve efficiency. So one common question, you know, to all of you all, looking back at your own institution, you know, can you tell us that how have you, you know, perceived this as when you are looking in your institution?
So I should start?
Yeah.
Good morning, everyone, and thank you, Dr. Desai, again for giving me the opportunity. And probably I'm the regular permanent feature of this hospital infrastructure, and I feel happy whenever I come and see more and more stalls and more participation. So with that, I want to start my responding your question.
So one thing I like to, you know, just interrupt you here. So one of the differentiator that we have tried to do, and we will be looking for feedback, you know, as you leave from here, is that we've tried to focus this on infrastructure bit of it and not too much of medical technology bit of it. That's the differentiation. We felt that, you know, something which misses out is the infrastructure. You know, everyone else is focused more on medical technology, you know, so that's one of the reasons, you know, for having a separate
session.
Yeah.
So as you told that many of you have visited Hinduja Hospital, which is 65 years old, or I say young hospital, and the building, which is, you know, iconic building in the next to the Arabian Sea, is close to 32 years old. When the hospital came up, we feel very proud to say it came up as a result of the collaboration with Mass General Hospital. And that time we got a lot of inputs, like the structure should be such its patients and their relatives, whoever is in your hospital premises, they should get a touch of nature. So the building was structured in such a way, it was like an X, and every patient room is open towards external environment, natural lights, and they feel comfortable in that way. The other very important factor what was included on those days, we realized the space should be such where one of the patient relatives also should be there next to the patient. So patients feel very homely, patients feel, you know, very very comfortable in terms of getting mental support from them and all this. But over a period of time, as you know, some of the new hospitals have come up in the city, in the country, all these have become a very basic primary level requirement to fulfill. We came up with different challenges. And what are those challenges? Even if you cross the hospital building today, you will get to see it looks pretty old structure, very old look and feel. The reason is, it is not that we are not keen to change, but a running hospital with 93-94% occupancy, we cannot give up on our business, close for some time and get it done. But what we are doing from inside, we are changing all this, you know, floor by floor and making it very pertinent to today's environment as per today's requirement. And what we are doing, when the hospital was built up in 1986 and subsequently, the entire hospital had centralized air conditioning and there was floor-wise control of air conditioning. We started getting patient feedback. Some people, they want more cooler, you know, temperature should be below 20, somebody wants 25, someone is feeling very cold. So it was a you know, nightmare for us. Maybe till 3-4 years back, it was difficult to handle all their requirements. So now, out of 10 floors of patient care areas, or I'm calling it as a ward, we have created all these rooms where separate temperature control, which is a basic requirement maybe probably for today.
Each room has separate control?
Each room has got now separate. So even if you want to switch off, even if you want to close off some of the areas to reduce the cost of electricity, we are able to do. And Dr. Desai is very much aware. Almost 2 years back, he used to quote in some of the forums that what is the electricity bill of Hinduja hospital per month. And he used to quote, I used to feel very bad, it used to be 1.4 crore per month for a size of 3.5 lakhs of square feet of build up area.
So I actually used to quote lower.
So, and then some of the things what we have done, of course everyone is talking about energy saving, electrical fittings, and then this AC work what we have done, and we have made lot of changes. And today, though the electricity tariff has gone up in comparison to 2 years back, our electricity bill is hovering between 1.1 to 1.15 per month, maybe little higher during summer, but almost in this range it is going on.
So can someone very quickly calculate, he said 3.5 lakh square feet and 1.5 crores billing, per square foot how much it is per month, can someone just do that? Yeah.
So he is giving teasers to you, good. The second thing what we have done, if you are familiar with our outpatient block, couple of floors again have been renovated, but very importantly we have designed a patient experience program. In that patient experience program, not only from the engineering and architecture point of view, but how to make your infrastructure to meet your customers, your patients' need, we have looked into it. And we didn't even look into the aspect while they are in your premises, we have also looked into when they are thinking or planning to visit you, and even after they leave your hospital, after they have spent 5-6 days when they are at home, what have you done to make their stay infrastructure wise, support wise, hospital service design wise compatible to them. So if I can share some of those, it may not be related to infrastructure, you know, building as such, but I can say overall hospital infrastructure. We have integrated a lot of IT aspects into it. We have integrated a lot of technology, non-medical technology, what do you call, into it.
So I'll come back to IT as a separate question. So okay. Let me just quickly go to, you know, Santosh. So Santosh, yours is probably, I may be wrong, but you know, maybe double the size of Hinduja, or probably even more than that in terms of built up area, is 3.5 lakh square feet. So yours is on.
Yes, sir. Can you hear me?
No.
Yeah, you can.
Okay. I'm loud enough in any case.
No, it is working.
So in terms of area, we are a 1 million square feet building. So,
so it's three times.
So it's a 3-acre plot with where we've used an FSI of 5. So in terms of area, it's a proper 1 million square feet facility.
And do you also have a ballpark of how much you spend in on energy?
Well, roughly we are spending currently about 1.75.
Per month?
Per month.
So three times the area and maybe 20% more. So please calculate his cost also. Okay.
So maybe just to carry on from where Joy left off, we are relatively younger. You know, we are just about 8 years old. So we had the luxury of, I would say, relatively starting from scratch because this was an existing building. It was a building which was planned to be a cardiac hospital. So about 5 lakh square feet was already built up when we came in. And we wanted to convert this into a multi-speciality hospital. So we changed quite a few things because as a cardiac hospital, very few diagnostics were planned, only dedicated towards cardiac. And we changed the whole thing to make it into a multi-speciality hospital.
So Santosh, let me just ask you this. 1 million square feet is for how many beds?
We have 750 inpatient beds and we've got 56 what we call relative accommodation rooms.
Okay, so about 800 accommodation and 1 million square feet.
Correct.
So can someone also calculate the area per bed? And yours, you know, Joy was 3,25,000 square feet and how many beds?
350,000. So 3,50,000 and we have 400 beds.
400 beds. Okay.
So when we started, clearly the mandate was that, you know, we need to make it like a very patient-centric hospital. So if there is one hospital that I would say, you know, we had the luxury of building by the book, I would say this would be definitely one of them. So in terms of giving natural light to all rooms, giving large corridors, large wait areas. So what we did originally when we sat on the drawing board was we tried to work out the patient flows. So we primarily focused on the three patient flows, which is the outpatient flow, the inpatient flow, and the emergency flow. And we wanted to segregate all the three flows. Because we wanted to minimize traffic, we wanted to make sure that there is as little crisscrossing as possible. At the same time, you share all the common diagnostics. What we did was, in the first and the second floor, we only kept all the outpatient and the diagnostic areas. As a policy, what we did was, in the whole of the ground floor, we don't have any patient care facility except the emergency. So we wanted to give a very inviting kind of an appearance. You know, we didn't want it to be very intimidating, not very typical hospital like. Most patients come and say that this is not a typical hospital, it doesn't smell like a hospital, it doesn't look like a hospital. So we wanted to give it a very positive, a very friendly, not that anyone likes to come to a hospital, but the idea was to make it as positive as possible. First and second floor, we said we'll only have the outpatient and the diagnostic areas. Now within these outpatient areas, what we also tried to do was, we tried to build in clusters with the diagnostics as part of these outpatient areas. So if I talk of a cardiac cluster, we have the cardiologist, the cardiac surgeon, and the cardiac diagnostics, everything sitting in one cluster. So what we call as the Center for Cardiac Sciences, within one OPD cluster, you've got the consulting rooms, the diagnostics sitting as part of it. So what this adjacency ensures is that patients don't have to come out of this cluster at all. Your registration, your billing, your flow from the doctors to the diagnostics all happens within this cluster. What this adjacency ensures is that we don't lose out on any diagnostics. So typically, if a patient comes out and has to go to another area or to another building, there is a tendency that he may think about, you know, going outside or maybe coming another day. But if you have the diagnostics that's adjacent to your OPD consulting, then immediately our capture of those diagnostics has gone up significantly. Similarly, if I were to talk of our Center for Diabetes and Obesity, we have the endocrinologist sitting in the consulting room, we have the vascular surgeon in the adjacent room, we've got the diabetic counselor, the dietitian, all and the vascular surgeon, all sitting as part of one cluster. The diagnostics, which is the foot profile and all the other lab diagnostics as part of that cluster. So the idea is, within a large multi-speciality hospital, we've been able to create these clusters of centers. So it still gives it a center kind of a concept within a multi-speciality hospital. So that's something that we deliberately tried to do within this. So that, I would say, was one of the ways of trying to distinguish and also create these centers. What we also tried to do was to build in adjacencies. Adjacencies in both outpatient areas as well as inpatient areas, both horizontal and vertical. So all our diagnostics are part of these first floor clusters. We have the health checkup, which is sitting right in the middle of these diagnostic clusters. So although the health checkup itself doesn't have any of its own diagnostics, there is very little travel across. So you're not moving from one floor to another, from one building to another. Everything is within a radius of 100 to 150 meters. So patients feel very comfortable being a part of this cluster. When we talk of vertical stacking, one of the things which we debated when we started was whether we have some diagnostics as part of the emergency department. You know, we did debate whether we should have a CT scan within the department, whether we should have large operating rooms there. But finally, we decided that since we had an option of vertical transport, since we had dedicated elevators within the emergency.
Can I ask you, how many floors, how many storied building you
have? So it's a two basements, ground plus 16 story.
And how many elevators?
We have 31 elevators.
Whoa.
And still we have people queuing for elevators and complaining that we don't have enough elevators.
So I think we need to learn from Joy, because Joy is 19, 14 floors?
We have ground plus 14, yeah.
And number of elevators?
See, ground plus 14, but our floor plates are much smaller than them. We have four buildings different.
Yeah, but transportation wise, you have how many elevators?
3, 6, 7, 8, 9.
9 elevators, 14 floors, 31 elevators?
17
floors. 17 floors. And still you have a problem?
Still we have a problem. Still we have a problem. So there are some learnings which I'll sure. share, you know, as part of it. So when we decided to, you know, debate about whether we have diagnostics, then finally we decided that let's stack it on one on top of the other. So right on top of the emergency, we've got our imaging. On top of that, we've got the theaters. On top of that, we have the cath lab. And on top of that, we have the ICU. So everything kind of, you know, we can just move vertically through
everything that an emergency patient needs travels.
Can straight go up without mixing with any of the traffic at all. So we have separate OPD elevators, separate A&E elevators, and separate inpatient elevators. On the inpatient side, what we did was we tried to build in flexibility within the room. So we've got an 8-meter grid. So we have two rooms of 320 square feet each fitting within that grid. So all the rooms are fitted out in such a way that you can have two beds within each of those 320 square feet rooms. So the bed head panels are camouflaged in such a way that at any point in time, you can open it up and have the bed head panel. So any twin room can be converted into a single room. A single room can be converted into a twin room. And then we've got clusters of single rooms with doors in between, which can be opened up. So single rooms, two single rooms can be converted into a suite. So depending on how the patient load is.
It's a modular way of design.
Correct. So depending on how the patient flow is, depending on what the load is, what the demand for the category of beds are, we kind of mix and we open up and convert these beds depending on what kind of.
So as on date, all beds are open?
All beds are open. All beds are open. Even within the emergency, we have a cluster of 6 beds which can be converted into full-fledged ICU beds at any point in time. So when the ICU bed load increases, this cluster gets isolated, we convert it into a full-fledged ICU.
So how much is the ICU complement out of 700?
We've got 180 ICU beds.
180. Yeah. And Joy, how many ICU beds you would have?
We have 53.
53.
For 400.
Okay, for 400. So it's about 10%.
16.
16%. And you are almost like 20%.
180 on 750. Yeah.
So 20%.
Maybe. Plus or minus, a little over 20%. Okay. Sorry.
Yeah, no, I thought that I'll pick sure. on, you know, yeah. I'll come back to yeah. you, sir. So you have heard, you know, two very large legendary names in healthcare in Mumbai. You come from a small, you know, city. You have seen, you have worked in AIMS, so you probably have worked in a hospital much bigger than that. But now when you are coming back and, you know, going into a tier 2 town and setting up a hospital there, how different it is from what you just heard?
Good morning, everybody. Thanks to Dr. Desai, we are here. What we do is exactly opposite to what we heard. Because we are driven by, I'm in Nagpur, which is 2.5 million population. So typically it's a large city. But we're surrounded by 50 districts, which are some of the poorest in the country. Madhya Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Vidarbha. Now, we face different challenges.
And you also belong to Nagpur?
I belong to Madhya Pradesh. And so I've grown up in small places. So the challenges are very typically what I would talk in an operational parlance, the RPOP, the revenue per occupied bed, what we can maximally expect. And our hospital in Nagpur is one of the more expensive hospitals, that's what we're told, is 14,000 rupees RPOP. Now at 14,000 rupees, we're offering neurosurgery, 600 surgeries a year, 200 spine.
So can I just get some vital statistics of your hospital?
Yeah, look,
how many beds?
I'll come to that. Yeah. So basically, when we started this model, so I saw Meditrina as a senior consultant from a private equity perspective. It was at a basement level. So I sort of handheld him because the promoter was a friend, and then we went through that. And it was envisaged as a surgery-driven hospital. So high throughput, high occupancy. So we said 120 beds to begin with, not more than that. We run at 90% occupancy. We are an NABH, NABL accredited hospital.
How many beds?
120 beds.
120.
Yeah, and we are at 90% occupancy right now. We have additional capacity to add another 125 beds by building another tower.
You have land for that.
Land for that, and the sanctions, etc., are already there. So, but in the last 2 years, since I became a partner to them, we're co-investing and working on things. We said, look, let's look at the catchment area. There are two big cities, Raipur and Jabalpur, but there are lots of smaller towns which are 2 lakh to 2.5 lakh population, with districts of about 10 to 12 lakh population. So our fundamental drawing board where we are today is that we have been successful in the last 5.5 years. This hospital is just 5.5 years old. So we are top 2 in neuro, top 4 in cardio. We started transplantation services. We are one of the first to move in. For liver, we are already planning. So in surgery parlance, we are always been ahead of the curve. So Anupam is not here. Wockhardt and Meditrina are the two main players in Nagpur today. We have, that's what it is. But today for us, our growth is not driven by Nagpur alone. While we are preparing for an addition of 300 beds in Nagpur and a new facility, wherein we would look at all the inspirations, but we are looking at one of keeping 700 square feet per bed as a norm.
700 square feet per bed. So yeah. Currently your 120 beds, how much
120
square feet?
120 beds, we're exactly at 650, 675 square feet per bed.
Per bed.
We have an ICU setup of almost 28%.
28%.
Yeah, because what we get is, we get a lot of patients in extreme critical condition.
So he is 16%, he is close to 22%, and you are the smallest of the lot, and you have the highest number of ICU beds. So do you make more money out of ICU, is that so?
We make more money out of ICU, but we make more money overall compared to others, because we are a surgery-driven setup. Critical care surgery-driven setup. So neuro, ortho, spine, cardio, GI surgery. So we are there in all those five spaces.
Can I just, 1 minute. Yeah. So how much is, the RPOP for you? Yeah.
For me?
KDA?
For us, sir. It's about a little over 1 crore per occupied bed.
Per annum.
Per annum.
Per annum.
Close to 1.5 crore.
Wow.
So I'm talking about in a daytime, in a daily parlance.
Yeah. So that is coming around 37,000.
Yeah.
A little over 30,000.
So 30,000 to 37,000, and yours is 40.
Typically, when we benchmark with, say, the Apollos of the world or a Max of the world, otherwise, typically they talk about 50,000 output.
I'm just trying to make some sense out of these numbers, that how hospitals are different in various.
Absolutely.
So when we, so what's your electricity tariff?
Electricity tariff is about something like 8 lakh rupees a month.
Our 8 lakhs per month.
8 lakhs.
We have. Electricity consumption is high. And
8 lakhs per month, no?
Yeah.
So this guy is like 1.5 crores and he's 1.75 crores. We are a smaller hospital.
But even then, it's not a very comfortable number. We would like to see how to look
at it. So we should do 1 lakh and, how much is the square footage?
This is 60,000.
60,000 square feet and, 8 lakhs, and we can get a per square feet.
It also depends upon the kind of equipments you have.
Yeah, so he is probably, a transplant, is a quaternary care.
CT, everything is equipment wise, we are no.
So except oncology.
Think about gamma knife, think about linear accelerator, all the time you have to
do
that. Yeah, so I'll have to arbitrate, sir. So he is not an oncology center, he is not
center. We don't want to be an oncology center.
Okay. You don't want to be an oncology center?
No.
Why is that?
National Cancer Institute has come in there.
It's a referral center.
So demand and supply is already met.
CT has come in, CTSI has come in. So it doesn't make sense to get into the same space.
True.
So we have been, we would continue to be a surgical, critical care driven player. Where we are going ahead, and which is where we are at the drawing board at a very late stage, final stage of drawing board, is We got the 60,000 square feet prototype design for a 100-bed hospital to be put up in these district headquarters, which we would call the tier 3 markets,
okay,
where the ARPOB drops even further. And 50 to 60% of those patients are social insurance models, the government social insurance models. So the ARPOB, unless you're in a surgical space, your ARPOB would even go down to 3,000 rupees. But if you're in a surgical-driven space, your ARPOB could be around 9,000 to 10,000 rupees. You know, that's kind of number we're looking at. That's a sweet spot. But it's partially air-conditioned. These hospitals we are proposing, which are in the drawing board right now, are partially air-conditioned, no basements because land is much
So all these centers will be partially air-conditioned?
Partially air-conditioned, ground first, second. No.
Is that okay with, you know, standards? And
NABH
can
is,
I just,
NABH,
you know, yeah. So yeah, I, because he is going to leave in a while. So can you just get me a mic, please? And sir, can you respond to this, you know, that this is one question which a lot of people ask us. And many of us probably are not able to answer, you know, that whether it should be air-conditioned centrally or not. Like he just now mentioned that, you know, prototype, and he is not looking at.
In fact, there has been a serious demand now that where this air conditioning should really be restudied once again. But let me tell you, from NABH point of view, we are not specifying that you should be centrally air conditioned, not at all. You know, we only have been emphasizing on the operation theater. That is our main emphasis, that must be air conditioned, laminar flow, positive pressure, HEPA filter, all that actually are focused only on the OT, not otherwise.
But how do you then ensure, sir, two air changes per hour?
Yeah, that of course is the issue where actually the expenses are really high, and it is very difficult to maintain the efficiency of the hospital from this point of view. In fact, while calculation is going on, I must tell you that per day, per bed expenses in the Hinduja kind of hospital or Kokilaben will not be less than 1,000 rupees almost per day per bed. That is the kind of expenses you are making on the electricity alone.
I see. Okay.
So if I may just further elaborate, we are looking at air conditioning or partial air conditioning. Mini chiller plant is what we are proposing for those operation theaters, the laboratories, the certain critical care space, etc. The general wards, it's a 60% general ward driven hospital, these prototypes. So the general wards would have air washers. So the temperature would have to be brought down because we live in an area where temperatures in summer touches 46, 47 degrees.
Can you explain what is an air washer?
Basically, it's a air cooling mechanism where air is sucked out and fresh air is inducted. But there is no, there is a filtration, but it is not the level. But it is not chilled. It's basically an exhaust kind of a thing. Exhaust, there's no chilling concept. It's like a cooler. So, but the humidity has to be maintained. That's exactly yesterday the ACOM was talking about. So we are looking at those aspects. We have done away with basements in these hospitals because we wanted to bring down the capex down drastically. The basement is twice the cost of a ground floor. So we have done this 22,000 square feet prototypes. Ground first, second. So 66,000 square feet would be the building. We have a small service block. Land is cheaper in these markets. That is one of the biggest advantages. We can't do that in Mumbai or some other places. Even in Nagpur, some places, we cannot do that. So we have actually done a lot of titration on the costing in the hospital. And look at appropriate technology, not over-the-top technology. And we have used a lot of IT for planning this entire thing, how to get the best of both worlds across. So. Like for example, aerated autoclaved bricks is like we feel is the right way to go. Why? Because we are in an area where we produce 90% of cement of the country. Chhattisgarh, Madhya Pradesh produces 90% of cement of the country. For getting aerated the bricks, the cost goes down drastically if you don't use bricks. The prototype cost goes down. Similarly, partial false ceiling, not entire false ceiling. So we have looked at every single aspect of whether it's MEP, whether it's civil and structural. What you're saying is that, look, the hospital has to be NABH. It should be upgradable by an addition of 8 crore rupees by another 100 beds. So
our
per bed cost, what we are envisaging, is around 22, 24 lakh rupees per bed, final finished product.
With equipment?
With equipment.
I'll 24 lakhs per bed?
I cannot go for a dual source CT in these markets. Understand that. Nobody can pay.
The government of India is unable to do that.
AIIMS spends 1.5 crore rupees per bed today. The fact is that. But today, the reality is that these markets cannot afford.
So how much is your construction cost?
Construction cost comes down to almost about 17, 18 crore rupees. And equipment, what we have done is...
No. I'm talking about per square feet.
Per square feet, it will come down to around 2,000 something. 2,000.
With air conditioning, with electrical, with
engine. I can share the details. We have spent a year and a half on working on these detailings and to going into details. Equipment, how do you differ is that people like Clear Medi, he's there, look at partners and say placement of equipments wherever possible.
Today, but 2,000 rupees a square foot for a building?
2,000 rupees is a basic bare minimum. After that, you have to add in the services. So it comes around 2,800 rupees somewhere. The equipment is extra over and above that. So if you look at per bed expense, so we talk about typically in all CII meetings, we talk about a crore of rupees per bed.
So 50 lakhs to a crore, you know. So yeah, crore may not be everyone.
These markets cannot take it. Either we give them hospitals or we don't give them hospitals. If you had to give them hospitals and that two NABH standards, which can have an attached nursing college and remain profitable, not through charitable institutions.
So no, why I asked you and why I asked sir also to, you know, because we are bidding for sir a AIIMS project in Bhatinda. You know, it's a town like what? And the brief mentions that it's a AIIMS, so it's going to be a 750 bed hospital. Has to be centrally air conditioned. I mean, this is government of India. Yeah. And on the other hand, you know, you have someone like you who's the.
See, Nagpur is getting an AIIMS, 1500 crores project, 150 acres is not even included in the cost.
No, but what I was trying to look at, and maybe anyone from audience also can contribute, is that a norm which is requires this, you know, air environment that an hospital has, and can you buck that norm? You know, government generally wouldn't do that, you know, because they don't have money to just, you know. But if there is some air changes per hour, you know, which is stipulated, then it is very difficult to do it in any other way than you may not be conditioning the air. So this air shower business probably might work.
The oxygenators requires 25 air changes. That is provided. It's modular. Again, the point we are trying to make is that wherever it is required, please spend the money. Wherever it is not required, don't spend money.
Yeah, I'm with you on
a
that.
A patient is not coming to look at the Italian marble on the floor. The patient in those markets. Kota is cheaper, use Kota. Maintenance is into the whole thing. Similarly, using technology has to be smartly handled. Don't go over the top. So everything has to be, like for example, if you today go for a dual slice, dual source, a 256 CT slice.
No, you don't need that.
We don't need it. Even a Nagpur cannot support it. Oh. But today, government hospital has it.
Well, 16 slice CT is more than enough.
Government hospital has it. Because there is nobody responsible for the capex. Here, see, end of the day.
No, it may also be, you know, so some element of research requirement gets, you know, satisfied by this high end equipment.
Absolutely.
So 3 Tesla MRI.
Yeah.
Probably is not required for, you know, more than but that 1%. But Kokilaben Ambani or an AIIMS or a PD Hinduja would need that because, you know, they for.
So basically, we are exactly diametrically opposite to where we are.
Yeah, no, it's a fantastic model. I must compliment you.
But
I'm little, you know, not yet convinced, and we can probably spend time offline. Yeah. You know about
lakhs.
That, yeah, about that 24 lakhs per bed, because
and we will by using your knowledge, if he makes consultancy, you take
I'll tell you something. One of the key things here is sourcing of raw material. Work it on labor contract. Don't work on contractor thing.
No, happy to learn. I'm telling you labor that because contract, that is the need of the hour.
Yeah. Now, if I have the idea is that most hospital projects don't start on time and they start and then they don't end on time. If you don't have the money tied in, you cannot do this. If everything is not done and all your partners are not tied in, you cannot do it. Other thing I'll tell you, we are also rolling out diagnostics independently. We have honed on 3 partners, that's it. No, like a lot of labs have multiple equipments. We have said, no, let's go with the best, but just 3 partners so that there's interchangeability. Today, the load in one hospital is higher. I have a lower end equipment. The lower end equipment can be shifted somewhere else, and I could shift the higher end equipment from another center to this. So it's a hub and spoke model we are looking at. Nagpur we are expanding, and even that expansion is going to be cost driven. It is not going to be, you know, the more expensive way of doing it.
Okay.
And
okay.
Because the patients, so, we get 60% of our patients from Madhya Pradesh and Chhattisgarh.
So, so coming back now, you know, to Joy and Joy, you know, I think I interrupted when you were talking about IT. You know, he began about IT. So let's hear from you. You know that how are you using information technology to be more efficient? Thank you so much, sir.
So, Dr. Desai, as I mentioned, the infrastructure is quite old and we are doing the renovation, we are you know, uplifting all these facilities. One of the things what we have done, we have strengthened our IT. So when you talk about IT, I'm not going to focus much on the HMIS and information system. Of course, that is state of the art and that is there for granted. But what we have done, I'll give you an example. In 2007, when I joined in this Hinduja hospital, my outpatient footfall used to be, for consultation alone, close to 450 to 500. And today, we have got close to 900 to 950.
Doubled.
It has been doubled. It is a problem, but it is a good problem to have. So when we got this in the same infrastructure without increasing a single square feet for the outpatient facility, we started looking at it that how do you take your patient's care away from your hospital, you begin and you deliver the care, whatever is necessary, only in your hospital premises. So you have done home care and all, that is okay, but in terms of when we realize that the number of counters what we have in the hospital for payment, registration and all, we have started doing all this through with the help of IT from patient's home. Like they can do the registration, they can fix appointment, they can pay through this money wallets and whatever. And we are very happy to say, before demonetization last year, we got all this in place close to 1 year before that. So when that demonetization happened, we are not at all challenged in that front. Further, what we have done, we can't add more manpower because our number of manpower is quite on the higher side in comparison to the industry standard.
Why is that?
The reason is, it's a legacy. The Hinduja hospital is a legacy. We talk about Hinduja hospital family, Hinduja hospital paribar, where we didn't even outsource a single department. So everybody who is working in Hinduja hospital today is a direct employee of Hinduja hospital.
So it's security, canteen.
Everything, anything and everything you see there, everyone is part of the Hinduja hospital full-time employment. So when we had that, we introduced not only this payment or online appointments and things like that, but we have got a host of services. For example, to say a patient who is going to be going take an appointment for next day, today they get an automated voice call to confirm their appointment, because we have seen very often it happens they take appointment, they don't turn up. So as a result of that, my resource may get lost, or we may waste our valuable resource of consultant time. So till previous day, if they have decided that they are not going to come, they can just tell automated voice message keeper that I am not going to come. So we have a call center backup and they can call and reschedule the appointment.
Your call center is off site?
It is in Navi Mumbai.
Wow.
So that is managed by our group company. So they manage our entire appointment, anything to do with hospital interfacing is completely taken away from the hospital. Second, the next thing what we have done, we have got lot of this Lean Six Sigma projects in place. And by virtue of getting that, today starting from discharge process, pharmacy medication request, doctors reporting, recording, PACS. When I say PACS, we are very happy to say it is not the typical PACS what you get to see in the hospital. Today, my hospital has got 100% speech to text conversion for the reporting, and that automatically triggers the report and it goes to the patient. Like doctor, they click, that report is generated and it automatically goes to the registered mail ID of the patient. So patient need not to come and stand in the queue. So we have tried to reduce the patient footfall in the hospital and try to serve them outside. The same thing we have done for the lab also. They need not to visit the hospital. Whether it is patient bill, today one of the major challenges what hospitals are facing about transparency. At any point of time in my hospital patient, they can log in with their registered hospital number and they can get to see the billing status as on that time.
Wow.
Every day morning they get automated message, the same amount goes as a message. If they are not accessing, they can get to see that. So we have brought all these aspects into it, whether it is getting integrated with some transportation service provider. We have kiosk, they can get it both, because we don't have much of parking space to provide them. So we have brought all these elements after a thorough study through this patient experience mapping for the outpatient, inpatient, and for the diagnosis.
So you mean to say you took customer feedback and then worked on it?
Customer feedback, we have created a group including patients, including doctors, nurses. Very importantly, we have brought all the representatives from all the segments as a part of the working group. And that group come up and tell, this is the pain point and you need to do either a value stream mapping or you have to do some sorts of, create some sorts of solution to meet and mitigate their challenges. So that is the way, just to give you an example, in last year, I'm talking about financial year 2016-17, we have done close to 22 green belt project in the hospital. So it has given result either in terms of the patient experience, in terms of integration of technology at different point of time, it may be related to cost control projects. So that's what we have done.
So, Santosh, you know, I had cut you off that time.
No, no.
So, was that, I wanted to ask you two things. One is this IT.
Right.
Is, are you doing something differently than what they are doing? And do you also have a, what do you say, call center off site? And the other thing that, you know, when I visited KDH, I have seen that, you know, one problem with this huge infrastructure is that you get lost.
Correct.
You know, and I think you have this kind of a
floor signage,
strips of, you know, colors going. So can you just explain what is that all about?
So first, to answer on the IT side, you know, we are doing a lot of things that Joy just mentioned. The idea is that today patients either don't want to come to hospital or want to spend as little time in hospital as possible. So whatever can be done online in terms of registration, billing, a lot of those things, you know, we are trying to do that much before the patient comes in. Whatever care can be provided at home. So like today, through the lab, home collection services, patient need not come at all. You know, you just call or send a message and someone will come home, collect the sample, and the reports will be emailed to you. So patient just doesn't need to come to the hospital at all. We've got queuing systems, so we've got kiosks where at all our major counters, so you come in, you pick up a token, and you have a good sense of how long you have to wait so that you don't start getting restless. We've also introduced Skype consults. So
I see.
Yeah, so we have a lot of patients coming in from out of town. And so you can go online, book, pay a consult, and then fix up a time and do a proper Skype consult. Because very often, it's more about follow-up. It's about, do I need to change the dose? I'm feeling better. This is my latest sugar. Do I need to do anything about it?
And you charge those Skype consults?
We charge Skype consult, and we charge actually about 10-15% higher because,
you know, he's not traveling,
and we block that time off for the doctor and do that. And it's a very.
Is there anything concept, you know, additional that one has to do for this Skype, or
nothing.
It's just the normal?
It's a typical thing. So the moment he logs on and he pays the fee online.
I'm talking from an infrastructure perspective.
Nothing really. It's a typical Skype consult. You know, as long as there is bandwidth and speed available, there's no problem at all.
It's a very good concept.
Yeah. So that's working very, very well. We've introduced the hospital app, so we are one of the few hospitals which has its own app. So a lot of information flows through from the app. We send out notifications, we send out reminders, any new services that are starting, we do that.
So if I log into an app of KDH, what will it tell me? Location of departments?
Yeah, so that's something we are building in right now. So we are just actually building in a beacon-based technology wherein once you enter the hospital, there will be complete wayfinding for you. And that's something, like you said, because of the size of our infrastructure, it's a challenge because it's a very linear structure, so patients do tend to get lost. So this will not only do wayfinding, but will also push notifications. So suppose you're passing by health checkup, you know, it can push a notification stating that, you know, why don't you get your health checkup done, and, you know, there is a 10% waiver that is there right now, or there's a new service we have started. So these are things that there's a constant flow of information that we can do using the app. So that's again something that we are trying to build.
Okay.
So the whole idea now is that patients want to spend less time. So like we see in airports, the number of self-check-in kiosks are increasing more and more.
Right.
And typically that's, I think, what's going to happen even with healthcare. People want to do everything at home and just come in for the minimal stuff to hospital. So we're trying to do more and more of that. We are using SMS gateways in a big way. So when you take appointments, SMSs get pushed. The day before you come in, SMSs get pushed. If doctor's appointments are getting rescheduled, suppose he's stuck in theater or anything, an SMS gets pushed. So a lot of that automation we are trying to build in.
Okay.
We have a call center which is on site, unlike what Hinduja has, because we had space and we said that we'll use that.
Anything on that?
Yeah. So one of the things that we realize is because it's a very very linear structure. So it's like a 100 120 meter span, and multiple departments in that span. Patients used to get lost. You know, they used to say that they would walk 10 meters and then they would start looking left and right and say, am I on the right track? So when you do a registration and billing, the customer care officer will tell you, okay, you want to go to the cardiac center, just follow the pink line. So there's a line which takes you straight from the counter right up to the cardiac center. You want to go to the center for diabetes, follow the yellow line. So there are multiple lines which are running across the building. So you actually see patients diligently looking down and actually following those lines. So that has actually helped in saving a lot of staff time, because otherwise everyone would stop some staff member along the way and ask, am I on the right track? Where is this center? So these floor signages are something that we've implemented, and they've been much appreciated by everyone.
But it works?
It works. It works beautifully. Okay. It works beautifully.
Okay. So, yes, doctor.
Yeah.
So I think IT probably for you is one of the key things if you are looking
key.
At,
Absolutely key. So in fact, a lot of services what Joy and Dr. Shetty talked about, we're incorporating it right in the beginning. What we did other thing was that, my coming from an investment background helped, we scouted for a company which had the core, an IT company, a small IT company, and we found a good IT company with a good IP. So we got into a strategic understanding with them that we'll help them to develop the things, and then we would get it at a different differential price. So that is the first thing we did about 1.5-2 years ago. And so currently, the pushing SMSs, et cetera, we're all doing. But what we started doing was we said our patients are all illiterate, largely illiterate. So vernacular, if a doctor wants to write something, which is...
So they generally pay you cash or...
See, we have both. We have cash, and also we get a lot of social insurance. So we had to cater to both. So for a smaller city, our social insurance, CGHS, government, the corporate tie-up, government hospital, these PSU tie-ups, add up to almost 50% of our cases. It's pretty high, and we are affiliated with most of the panels.
So it's all three states, Chattisgarh?
Yeah, MP. All three states. There is Maharashtra has this Mahatma Phule scheme now, and there is another scheme in Madhya Pradesh, and similar scheme exists in Chattisgarh. Plus, a lot of industries are there. So you have WCL, which doesn't pay money for every 6 months, and there are lots of issues. But coming back to technology, for us, technology is the lifeline. Let's say the hospital we're setting up is 135, 200, 300 kilometers away, these 100-bed prototypes. Right in the day one, we're incorporating the telemedicine backbone. For example, we are rolling out the STEMI program, the ST elevation management of MI, right from day one. Right now, the prototype is working in Nagpur and a couple of hospitals. We're checking out whether it's running in this place. Because if a patient comes with an MI at 150 kilometers away, the intervention has to be done. A cardiologist may not be there at the time, will not be there actually. So the cardiologist gets online and handles the critical care patient there, so that the embolism, the thrombus is broken. Then the patient can be transported. So that is one of the things. So saving lives is the bottom line for us. Stroke, again, we do a lot of stroke patients. We see about 650 stroke patients in our hospital every year. So hemorrhagic or otherwise, hemorrhagic we cannot.
That's almost about two a day.
Yeah, we do. We see a lot of stroke. So we started off more as a neuro-driven setup, but neurocardio core areas for us. So for us, the telemedicine backbone is absolutely important. Our biggest challenge today, what we're facing, is that we've been really patiently waiting for Jio to really take off. But reality is that in these district setups, the broadband availability is...
They don't think still have a commercial license.
In most of these places, like even if I ask for a 1 Mbps dedicated from BSNL, and I want a redundancy with another service provider. There's no second service provider. So one has to depend on BSNL alone, which is dangerous. So currently we are working on a platform that, okay, BSNL and a Jio, a dongle kind of a thing. So the visuals cannot be seamless. If it's 1 Mbps, it can be seamless. So the basic backbone for us is this program runs on the basis of the fact that we have a robust IT network. So we have invested, or rather almost invested, into a company which has got a robust HIS and LIS. So that has capabilities which we have built into it, like vernacular writing. If a doctor wants to explain in Hindi or Marathi, it has the capability to take that into it. SMS phishing, etc. Today, telecom penetration is huge in rural area, but smartphone utilization is very poor. So they use WhatsApp and SMS, but if we ask them to send something, it's very difficult. We can send them something, they can. It has to be very simple. So we've done a lot of design engineering on these aspects with outsourced IT partner, but who is like a partner to us. We have actually taken them through the process and come to a robust solution today. So that's our backbone. So Skype calling is already part of it. We pegged it at 200 rupees for the consultation. And the STEMI program is still in a beta stage, so we'll have to see how to peg it up. We have got these diagnostic setup rollout happening, which is a basic diagnostic. It's like the pathology, X-ray, ultrasound. We don't want to get into a CT, this thing. So that particular thing is driven by OPD, virtual OPD presence.
So is it, you know, suppose you put up these imaging centers in smaller towns, is the Indian laws allow that you can report it, you know, from Meditrina?
Radiology reporting is allowed. Pathology, there is a bit of a query on that.
Okay. No, electronic signature is allowed.
Electronic signature is allowed, but there are time to time some people do create queries, but telepresence, teleradiology is completely allowed.
Okay.
So since we don't have higher modalities of imaging in terms of radiology, that is comfortable there. Okay. And local partner, we've identified local, for example, a gynecologist or a general surgeon who's got the capability to do ultrasound as the partner. Investing of machine is ours, but the PCP entity is a big headache right now. So something happens and the entire management gets kicked into that. So this is what we're trying to do. So technology for us is the backbone.
Okay. So I think as we were talking, you know, and from the first question, we got it back. Santosh, KDH is 1250 square feet per bed. In terms of area, you know, and you spend about 18 rupees a square foot in terms of energy. This is on a per month basis. Hinduja Joy is 900 square feet per bed and it spends about 43 rupees a square foot. So you still probably has, you know,
some more scope.
Yeah. Meditrina, of course, you know, 700 square feet per bed, which is not actually bad, and only 7 rupees a square foot.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah. So this makes a lot of difference if you don't have a central AC. So I'll now leave that, you know, questioning to the audience. If you have any questions to ask, ask them. You've heard, you know.
Who wants to ask?
One of the hospitals are vertically stacked. The other one is horizontally planned. Now, in terms of air conditioning efficiency, do these formats really do have a sort of a say, or do they, their efficiency levels go down, or however it is?
So I think we'll ask any air conditioning expert to talk on that, you know, because this panel probably may not. So is there my colleague, someone there from, can reply to him?
I can answer one thing, what I have learned during our this, you know, trying to, what we're trying to do to bring down the cost, that whether you have rooms vertically, horizontally, it hardly matters, or it hardly becoming a differentiated factor. But the most important thing is what kind of medical equipments you have, operation theater complex, how big it is. They are the major areas where it is going to consume. So by reducing 10 beds, you may be reducing very minimum amount of consumption, but if you have one of the MRIs and the AC and everything is on for throughout the night, that is going to take away huge electricity. That is my experience.
But as said and done, unlike your hospital where only specific places you have air conditioning, whereas both in your both cases, it is all centrally air conditioning.
Yeah, but what he's saying is, so in his case also, MRI, OT, ICU, you know, MR, everything has to be air conditioned. He has no choice there. He's probably not doing it in corridors, you know, lobbies, general wards like that. So what he's trying to tell you is that, you know, these areas you can't do anything. Whatever is given has to be mentioned, and unfortunately all of that. So, you know, say for an operation theater, it needs to be under positive pressure 24 hours, 365 days. You know, so many of us don't do it. You know, you do, sir? You don't do. So he doesn't do it. So maybe that 7 rupees has to become 12. All right. Is there anyone else who can answer his question, or I'll go to the next question? Yeah.
Yeah, hello, I'm architect Preeti Chauhan. I've been working 18 years in healthcare sector, only designing hospitals. Just to answer back to your question that you had posed to them, design does have an impact on energy efficiency.
No. His question is that verticalness.
I'm just coming down to that. When there is a huge loss of energy, or you consume more energy when the ducting and the piping and those systems are enhanced in a building. So it does, the design does help. If you are stacking them all together, then probably you are able to reduce the ducting and the loss of heat or the gain of heat through ducting in these.
So what you are saying is it is better to do a vertical building?
It's always good to go for
better a vertical building. Is that, does she answer your question?
One more thing, the convention is cool air tends to come down. There is a natural pressure.
Yeah, but that is within a floor. That would be within a floor. The whole building, you know, is ducted and air comes like that. So that's a separate thing. So I think I have been already warned, you know, from there, and they have showed me 0 minutes.
Yeah.
You know, so I think I'll have to close this down, you know, because we like to maintain time and we are on time, right? So I know all three of you are a busy, you know, kind of people. I think a loud round of applause. You know, you have learned a lot. Thank you so much, sir. But you know, just wait for a moment on the stage. So is Vikas there? Vikas is not around. So I will take the privilege of, you know, doing this honor. So can you just, yeah. Thank you so much, Joy. Thanks, Santosh. Well, excellent meeting you. We must meet.